This is the new 2022 Hyundai Santa Cruz, and it's a pickup truck from Hyundai. Hyundai isn't exactly the top name in pickup trucks, and this isn't exactly a traditional truck. It's based on the Hyundai Tucson crossover, and it's more of a truck for car people. And today, I'm going to review it. Before I get started, be sure to check out Cars and Bids, which is my enthusiast car auction website for cool cars from the modern era. We've had some amazing sales recently on Cars and Bids, including this McLaren 570S, beautiful car, sold for $140,000, this Lotus Elise, which sold for just over $40,000, and this Volkswagen Passat W8 wagon with a 6-speed manual transmission, which sold for just under $20,000, a very rare car. If you're looking to sell your cool enthusiast car from the modern era, Cars and Bids is the place to do it. And if you're looking to buy a cool car from the 1980s and up, check out Cars and Bids daily auctions with great selection at carsandbids.com. So let's talk Santa Cruz. Hyundai isn't calling this a truck. Instead, they're calling it a sport adventure vehicle, which is a stupid marketing term, but it gives you the idea that they're not targeting traditional truck buyers, or else they'd call it a truck. Now, like I said, it's based on the Hyundai Tucson crossover, and it's unibody in its design rather than body on frame like tough pickup trucks. And indeed, this isn't as tough as most trucks. For one thing, it's only offered with 4-cylinder engines. The base level engine has 190 horsepower, or you can upgrade to a turbo 4-cylinder like this Santa Cruz with 280 horsepower. It's also front-wheel drive with optional all-wheel drive rather than rear-wheel drive like most other pickup trucks. So this isn't your typical pickup truck, but Hyundai seems to think there's a market for it. People who want a truck, but don't want a truck. Ford also seems to think there's a market here, as they recently revealed the new Maverick tiny compact pickup truck, which kind of stole the Santa Cruz's thunder a little bit because the Maverick is way cheaper. The Santa Cruz starts around $25,000 with shipping. The Maverick starts at just $21,500 with shipping. But the Santa Cruz has more stuff, and that's especially true of this top-of-the-line limited model. Starts around $40,000 and has a lot of equipment. And today, I'm going to show you everything. First, I'll take you on a tour of the Santa Cruz and show you all of the interesting quirks and features of the new Hyundai truck thing. Then I'll get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'll give it a DOUGSCORE. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the Santa Cruz by going through the bed, because this is the first ever Hyundai to have a bed, so it'll be interesting to see how they did it. I'm gonna start with the tailgate. You can see Santa Cruz is stamped into the tailgate going across the entire thing. This is not a decal, this is stamped right in there, making it very clear that you are looking at the Santa Cruz, the new Hyundai pickup, or sports adventure vehicle, whatever they call it. But anyway, beyond the tailgate, moving on to getting into the bed area, there are two ways to open the tailgate. You can push a little button under Hyundai back here in this little handle area, and that will release the tailgate, and then you can drop it from there. Or you can press this little button on the key fob that shows a pickup truck with its tailgate down and says hold. You press and hold that, and then the tailgate drops, as you can see, and that gives you access to the bed. Except you still don't quite have full access to the bed because there's this cover on top of it. Hyundai says this is a locking bed cover, although I can't quite figure out how to lock it. But still, to open this cover, you pull up on this little Hyundai latch back here, you can see, and then the cover just retracts and gives you full access to your bed area. You can obviously see why you would want a bed cover like this on there. If you have stuff in the bed, you don't want it to get dirty or wet or stolen, whatever, you can have this cover and you can just slide it back for full access to the bed. But anyway, just in case you want even more storage than you get in the bed of the Santa Cruz, there is an extra little trunk hidden underneath the bed. You can see on the bottom of the bed over to the left side, there's a piece marked open. If you stick your hand in here, you can press a little button that releases this large plastic panel, and then you can lift it up And then that's an extra storage compartment under there. As you can see, it's like a little hidden bed trunk that gives you even more privacy for your stuff if you want to make sure that nobody can see it or access it. One other interesting thing about this little hidden bed trunk area is that there's a drain. You twist this little drain plug, and then you can see it just drops out to the bottom underneath the truck. So you can fill this up with, for example, ice if you want to use it as an in-truck bed cooler if you're tailgating at some sporting event or whatever, and then when you're done, you can just let the ice melt and drain it out through this little drain. That is a pretty cool touch. And by the way, if you're looking for even more storage in the bed of the Santa Cruz, you have that too. On the sides of the bed, you can see this little rectangular compartment. You twist these little fasteners, you can open it up, and then you have little extra storage compartments for smaller items that you don't maybe want rolling around in the bed while you're driving. You have these compartments on each side, and on the passenger side compartment, you also have a household style power outlet in here, so you can power stuff in the back of your Santa Cruz, and the outlet will stay dry since it's inside this little rectangular compartment when it's not being used. That's pretty cool. Now, even though there are some clever tricks to this bed and some nice hidden storage areas, there is one big drawback, and that would be bed size. This is only a 4 foot long truck bed, which is pretty small. And obviously this is a unibody vehicle, only comes in one body style, so there's not gonna be like a long bed version. 4 feet long is all you get. That's smaller than the smallest bed offered by most traditional trucks. The Toyota Tacoma's smallest bed size is 5 feet long, and there are longer bed sizes available, and that's true for most other trucks. So a 4 foot bed, you're not really gonna be able to fit like ATVs back here. With that said, Hyundai says the payload capacity for the Santa Cruz maxes out at around 1,750 pounds, which is more than the Ford Maverick, this thing's biggest competitor. Maverick only goes up to 1,500 pounds, so you can throw more stuff in the bed of this, although the Maverick's bed is actually bigger. One other interesting bed-related item on the bumpers, you can see little cutouts back here. Those are for side steps, so you can step into the bumper and reach into the bed. A lot of pickup trucks have this. Kind of weird to see on this truck though, because it's so low and so small, it's pretty easy to just reach into the bed from the side, as you can see. But if you want to use the side steps, you can also put your foot in there and climb over and then reach into the bed. I'm not really sure that will be useful or helpful, but it's there if you want it. And next up, I want to move on to some interesting exterior quirks of the Santa Cruz. One of them starts in the bed. You can see the entire bed liner is triangles. At the bottom of the bed, it's all a bunch of little triangles down here. So you're thinking, okay, well, that's not really all that weird, but the triangle theme is only just beginning in the bed. You close the tailgate, you can see triangles all over the rear bumper of this truck, on every surface, triangle, 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 and right in the middle of all the triangles, you have a little molded plastic image of the truck in profile, sort of a cool-looking Santa Cruz amongst all the exterior triangles on the bumper. And as you look around the outside of this truck, you can find a few other areas where there are little Easter eggs hidden among a lot of triangles. For instance, along the bed rails on the side of the bed, you can see triangles, 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 and then again, that little profile image of the Santa Cruz amidst all the triangles. By the way, it's worth noting that these bed rails are made of plastic so that when you want to load stuff into the bed, you don't damage like the paint on the side of the bed. Instead, you're just loading it over plastic, which won't damage as easily and can easily be replaced. But they're also covered in triangles with that little image of the Santa Cruz. And next up, another example of the triangles in the Santa Cruz Easter egg is on the wheel arch. You can see here this plastic wheel arch going over the entire wheel is full of triangles, of course, and there's this little panel that sticks up off the wheel arch with an image of the Santa Cruz in profile. Once again, that image hiding among all the triangles. And you have this front and rear. In the front, you also have all these triangles on the wheel arch and this little piece that sticks up with the image of the Santa Cruz on it as well. Worth noting, by the way, I think this is a really strange piece of design and not a good looking one. The wheel arch is just fine, the triangles, but this little panel that sticks up, I think just looks really odd, totally out of place. I'm not sure why they bothered to do that except to stick this little truck profile in it. And I think it really does look strange. The wheel arch should probably just stay curving rather than have this odd panel sticking up doesn't look all that good. And since we're on the outside of the Santa Cruz, we gotta talk styling, which is very interesting, isn't it? Looks quite distinctive, very different from basically everything else on the road. And a lot of people have been coming up to me as I've been driving this around and saying, what is this weird Hyundai sort of pickup car thing that you're driving? It certainly turns heads a lot more than I was expecting. And you know, it's interesting, the Santa Cruz's biggest competitor will obviously be the new Ford Maverick, and they've both taken two totally different approaches to design. The Maverick has a more traditional sort of boxy, tough truck type look, whereas this is definitely more kind of weird, swoopy, interesting, car crossovery like, and I think it speaks to the markets that they are targeting. The Maverick is trying to target more traditional truck buyers, and this, I think, is going after maybe crossover buyers or people who want something interesting, different, or weird, and that difference definitely shows in the designs. This design, pretty unusual for sure. With that said, there's one part of the Santa Cruz that doesn't really look all that distinctive or unusual, and that would be the front end. Now, I mentioned earlier the Santa Cruz is based on the Hyundai Tucson, which is their compact crossover. And although I think they've done a great job of distinguishing the Santa Cruz from the Tucson and not just making it look like a Tucson pickup truck, in the front you can clearly see the resemblance. In fact, from this angle in the very front, you'd probably think you were just looking at a Tucson until you saw more of the side and you could see the pickup truck bed. Especially distinctive and borrowed from the Tucson is the LED running lights up here. You can see they're in this kind of weird formation, a unique design detail to the Hyundai Tucson, which is carried over to the Santa Cruz since they kind of share the same front end. Another interesting Tucson detail that also appears in the front of the Santa Cruz is the headlight placement. It is not up here, sort of at the top of the grille like in most cars. Instead, it's down here almost in the bumper. That's where the headlights are. Doesn't really change it when you're driving at night. Still looks fairly similar, fairly normal, but it's certainly unusual and kind of distinctive to the Tucson and now the Santa Cruz as well. And speaking of lighting, the rear lights are fairly normal in this truck thing, although there are two interesting items worth noting. One is when you turn on the headlights, the taillights come on back here and they're pointed like arrows to the sides of the truck, which is kind of an interesting thing to see, and again, a distinctive look. One other interesting item in these taillights, you can see around back, it says designed in California, which I find to be interesting. This truck is made in Alabama, but that's not printed anywhere on the outside. Instead, it says designed in California, which again gives you a little bit of an idea of the market segment Hyundai is trying to appeal to with the Santa Cruz. Traditional truck shoppers might not be so proud that their vehicle was designed in California. A lot of the middle of the country truck drivers have kind of sworn off California, but they put this on there probably to appeal to the coastal young people who view California as still aspirational and kind of a dream. And so that design in California does kind of give you an idea of who they're trying to pitch this truck to. And finally, our last exterior item with this truck is sizing. The Santa Cruz is 195 inches long, just about. That makes it about the same length as a midsize sedan. In fact, it's only a couple of inches longer than the Hyundai Sonata, which is Hyundai's own midsize sedan. That's a pretty maneuverable, kind of city-friendly, compact dimension for this truck, but makes it a lot smaller than most traditional trucks, even small ones. The Toyota Tacoma with a crew cab and the short bed is 18 inches, a foot and a half longer than the Santa Cruz. So the Santa Cruz is midsize sedan size in terms of length, and by truck standards, it's pretty small, which is exactly what they're going for, sort of a city-friendly, compact truck. That's what this is supposed to be. And next up, we move inside the Santa Cruz, the interior, which is a lot less interesting than the exterior. In here, it pretty much just looks like a Hyundai crossover. Nothing especially interesting or unusual in here. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. Hyundai crossovers are at the point where they have pretty nice interiors, but the funky, interesting exterior of this car is definitely not matched by a similar funky interior. It's all just pretty standard in here, which is a little disappointing to me. Probably the only interesting or unusual piece is this cloth trim that goes from the door panel onto the dashboard, and then over on the passenger side, there are some little orange lines in the cloth trim. But that's pretty much all that makes this interior stand out from like a Tucson or a Santa Fe or one of Hyundai's normal vehicles. But anyway, let's talk features. Now, all Santa Cruz models come standard with Apple CarPlay, Android Auto, and a lot of safety safety features, including stuff like lane keep assist. There's a lot of technology that's standard in the Santa Cruz, and that helps it justify its price. Like I said, it starts around $25,000 with shipping compared to around $21,500 for the Maverick. Maverick's a lot cheaper, but the Santa Cruz has more stuff. Now, this is a Santa Cruz Limited, the top of the line luxury model. Sticker price is probably in the low $40,000 range for this one, and it has a lot of stuff. For instance, you got heated seats up here and cooled seats, which is nice, and a heated steering wheel. You can see in this row of buttons here, a lot of nice stuff. You also have a digital gauge cluster, a full screen gauge cluster in here. In addition to the center screen, you have one in the gauge cluster. And there are a few interesting items that come along with that screen gauge cluster. One thing I love is the blind spot camera system, which is fantastic. You're cruising along on the highway, you put on your turn signal, and it turns on a camera that shows what's in your blind spot, what's in the lane next to you. And that makes it a lot easier to make lane changes when you're driving. It works both ways, left or right. Each time you put on your signal, a blind spot camera turns on in your gauge cluster to let you know what's going on. That feature is in a lot of new Hyundai and Kia models, and I absolutely love it. A fantastic safety feature. Less practical and more downright weird is the configurable gauges in this gauge cluster. Okay, like in most cars, you change the drive mode and the gauges will also change a little bit to correspond to each drive mode. You can see sport is a little sportier, whatever. But if you go into the center screen, you can also configure the gauges to be in a cube setting, which looks like this. This is probably the single most bizarre configurable gauge I have ever seen in any car. Instead of a circle, you have a cube behind the numbers that tell you your RPM and your speed. Absolutely weird that that's even available, but it is. You can turn on the cube setting if you want. Now, as for the infotainment system, worth noting, this is the same system in a lot of other Hyundai and Kia models, which I've reviewed, and I'll link a few of those reviews in the description below. It's a pretty good system, very responsive, reasonably intuitive, although I do wish that the home screen gave you a little bit more information. It shows you like the temperature and what you're listening to, but it would be nice to see like the map of where you are and maybe a few other pieces of information on that home screen. A lot of other cars have like a three-panel home screen that tells you more stuff, but not this one. Otherwise, generally speaking, great infotainment system, very usable, very easy. One other control worth highlighting in the center, there's a little button here that says lock, and it looks like a differential locker, like you might see on a real off-roader SUV. Worth noting though, it isn't a differential locker. Instead, it turns on the all-wheel drive system and forces it to have a 50-50 front and rear split, and it only works at lower speeds, up to like 20, 25, 30 miles an hour, something like that. So you don't get a differential locker in this. In fact, you don't really have a lot of off-roading capabilities, just all-wheel drive, and then that little button, which can enhance things a little bit. And next up, we move on to the back seat in the Santa Cruz, and I have to say, sitting back here, I can tell it is a pretty tight fit. I have the front passenger seat where I would have it if I was sitting in here, and sitting back here, I really do not have any space. My knees are pushing up against the seat, really digging into it. There's not a lot of space back here if you plan to transport adults in the front and in the back. And when you think about it, it kind of makes sense. 195 inches long, mid-sized sedan length, but in order to stick a bed and a comfortable front seat on a car that size, you gotta compromise some room somewhere, and Hyundai has done that clearly in the back seat. It's usable and certainly usable for children. It's just not huge back here, so don't expect this to have a massive interior, because in back it just doesn't feel all that big. With that said, one interesting and cool trick in back is the seat bottoms themselves lift up. You have this little loop on the side of the seat. You pull that, you lift up the seat bottom, and you have storage back here. You can put stuff in the back. Over on the passenger side, you can do the very same thing, and you can see the tire changing equipment is back here, but you can remove it if you want for more storage. This gives you even more sort of lockable private storage. If there's stuff you don't want rolling around in the bed, visible, accessible, now you can put it down here, and then no one will really know that it's there. A couple other interesting items back here. For one, I like that the rear window opens behind the rear seats. You can open up with this latch and then slide it to the side and open it, just like in traditional pickup trucks. It's good that they didn't get rid of that because it's kind of a cool feature and allows for airflow, and it's nice to see that here. I also like the fact that there are two USB ports for charging devices back here, which is always nice, and you even have rear seat climate vents, which is a nice touch. Like I said, not huge back here for rear passengers. Probably not going to be buying this if you want to transport people all the time, but having vents and charging charge ports does increase the comfort and convenience in the back seats. And finally, we move under the hood in the Santa Cruz. We'll go over the engines. The base engine is 190 horsepower, which is about the same as the Ford Maverick, but the Santa Cruz has a towing advantage. The base level Santa Cruz can tow 3,500 pounds, while the base Maverick can only tow 2,000 pounds. Now, if you upgrade to the optional engine in the Santa Cruz, this engine, you get 280 horsepower, which is a pretty muscular figure, and your towing capacity increases to 5,000 pounds, which is a pretty big figure, and again, an advantage over the Maverick, which only has a 4,000 pound towing capacity in its top engine, which is only about 250 horsepower. So the Santa Cruz has an advantage in terms of payload capacity, towing capacity, and horsepower, although the Maverick has the price advantage, and the Maverick also gets better gas mileage. Santa Cruz is around 23 miles per gallon in combined city highway driving with both engines, but Ford says they're targeting almost 40 miles per gallon with the base engine in the Maverick, and that gives it a big, big fuel economy advantage, especially for a little city pickup truck. That's going to be a big deal for some shoppers. And so those are the quirks and features of the new Hyundai Santa Cruz. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the Santa Cruz. Now, two things I want to cover real quick. Number one, this goes on sale, kind of they said late summer, so I'm thinking within the next few weeks or maybe the next month. I also want to talk about the Honda Ridgeline, because a lot of people are going to ask me why I'm not comparing this to the Ridgeline. And the answer is the Ridgeline is sort of a different class up of vehicle, basically. Like I said, this starts around $25,000. The Ridgeline starts around $39,000. It's just like the next level up. And I consider that to be more of a competitor for mid-sized trucks like the Toyota Tacoma, that sort of thing. It gives like a car-based alternative to those trucks. And if you want to think about it, think of the Ridgeline as like a mid, like a Camry or a Sonata or an Altima. And then this is more like a Toyota Corolla Honda Civic type truck, like a compact, true compact, like little truck. So what do I think of driving this? I'm actually kind of in an interesting position here because I'm one of the few people probably who spent time with both the Maverick and the Santa Cruz. I didn't get to drive the Maverick, but I did kind of spend the day poking around it. And so it was some interesting comparisons. First thing, this is clearly nicer. The Maverick is clearly going to be intended for more of kind of a workhorse, budget-minded type of buyer. And I think part of the reason for that is that Ford has the Ranger in its lineup, and so they don't necessarily want to make the Maverick too expensive, too nice, too capable, because you're going to start eating into Ranger sales. So the Maverick is definitely positioned sort of a lower level than the Santa Cruz. This is nicer, it has more tech, it has more power, it has more capabilities, that sort of thing, but it also costs more. You're going to be paying for that stuff. And like I said, this one, the one I'm sitting in the Santa Cruz is probably in the low $40,000 range, $42,000, $43,000 for a four-cylinder car-based crossover with a four-foot bed. It's some money. Now, on the road, I have to say, it drives like a crossover. In fact, if you're sitting up here, you wouldn't know that you're in anything different from a Tucson or a Santa Fe, except for the fact that I know I'm in a Santa Cruz and I look in the back and I see that window right back there. That's it. This really, really sitting up here feels like a crossover. And like I mentioned, from an interior design standpoint, it's a little disappointing. The Maverick does a pretty good job of kind of making an interesting, cool, unique interior. This definitely just has a Hyundai interior. Now, Hyundai interiors have gotten pretty nice, and this is a nice interior, but you do miss some of the, like, the exterior is funky, and this is a weird car trying to enter a new segment. You get in here and it just doesn't feel like interesting, but that might be a benefit when it comes to driving it, because it does feel like a fairly traditional crossover. It drives like a crossover, and I think Hyundai's goal with this car is to try to get crossover buyers to buy it. People who are interested in the Tucson, maybe they want a little more capability, maybe they want something a little different, maybe they want to go haul a couple of dirt bikes or mountain bikes or something like that. That's kind of what they're thinking for this. This will be sort of a vehicle for people like that. And from a drivability perspective, I suspect those people would feel right at home in this car. It does feel like a crossover. It does not come with your usual pickup truck drawbacks like sizing and like excessiveness and all that. It has car-like driving experience, car-like interior, and I think those things will be benefits to the people who buy this. With that said, I don't think a lot of people are going to buy this. I find it interesting that Hyundai decided to make this their entrance into the pickup truck segment. They didn't want to do a full-size truck because they don't have a lot of credibility in the full-size vehicle world, and they knew it would be a tough slog to build that credibility. It's taken Nissan years with the Titan to get where they are now, and they haven't really gotten all that far. And even the Toyota Tundra hasn't been as successful as Chevy, Ford, and Chrysler, the Rams. So they decided to go with something a little different, and I just don't think there's a big market for this. I think a lot of my friends are the kind of people who are the market, and I don't see a lot of them buying a vehicle with a bed. It just makes more sense to get a cargo area back there if you can. Hyundai, I think, is going to try to pitch this against stuff like the Mazda CX-5 and the Hyundai Tucson. Like, here's a truck bed alternative to those. I just don't see a lot of people buying that, to be totally frank. I think this is the Subaru Baja of the 2020s, and I think it's going to sell similarly, and I think it's going to be a dismal failure, and they'll only do one generation. However, I think, like the Baja, it will probably develop a bit of a cult following in years to come because it offers something that nothing else does, which is basically a truck that's a car. There will be tens of thousands of people for whom that is the perfect vehicle. But there won't be more than that. And I think a lot of people in this segment are just going to get a Bronco Sport, an Escape, various different other small crossovers. And so that's the new 2022 Hyundai Santa Cruz. This is a neat little sort of truck, and I'm thrilled this segment appears to be developing. The return of the cheap-ish, smallish, maneuverable, city-friendly truck. This is a cool one, and I'm excited to drive the Ford Maverick later this year to provide a comparison. Anyway, now it's time to give the Santa Cruz a DOUGSCORE. Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the Santa Cruz will certainly be controversial. I like it, but I suspect many won't. It gets a 6 out of 10. Acceleration does 0 to 60 in the high 6-second range with the larger engine I drove, and it gets a 2 out of 10. Handling is fine, like a crossover, and it gets a 3 out of 10. Fun factor is low. Aside from the look of it, it's not especially fun, and certainly not when you're inside, and it gets a 2 out of 10. Cool factor is relatively low. The Santa Cruz is interesting and head-turning and new, which makes it kind of cool, so it gets a 4 out of 10, but I see that dropping after it's been out a while. It finishes with a weekend score of 17 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. The Santa Cruz is well equipped and it gets a 6 out of 10. Comfort is normal for a crossover and it gets a 6 out of 10. Quality is very good. The interior is nice and you have Hyundai's long warranty and it gets 7 out of 10. Practicality is only okay. It's less practical than a normal crossover, though it's more parkable than a pickup truck. It gets a 6 out of 10. Finally, value. And frankly, I think this is overpriced. At least the one I drove. Over 40 grand for a little car truck thing. It seems like a lot, especially since that money will buy you a real truck with real truck capabilities. It gets a 5 out of 10 for a total daily score of 30 out of 50. Added up, and the DOUGSCORE is 47 out of 100, which places the Santa Cruz here against other relevant small trucks and crossovers. It does fine, but personally, if I wanted a smaller truck, I'd buy one. And if I wanted a crossover, I'd buy one. And I suspect the combination of the two won't find many buyers, especially at this price point.